Everything's working on my end now. It's just the computer.
We are live, Julia. And our guest today is Kate Gladstone, who is a handwriting expert. And she's going to tell us about handwriting reform in the Czech Republic and Slovakia. Without further ado, Kate Gladstone.
Yes, thank you, by the way, for having me. Julia, it looks like you were just cooking today. And that's very apropos because the Czech Republic and to some extent Slovakia has been trying out a new recipe for how do they teach kids to write. They've actually been trying this for about 10 years and doing longitudinal research studies. The results look good. You know, public opinion is the usual mix of this is cool, we don't know what this is, and this is going to destroy our civilization. But if you could put up some of the graphics and so on we have, you know.
Oh, yeah, dude, let's go ahead and start.
Yeah, let's do that because it's easier to give people some content.
Yeah, we will go ahead and start with that.
I actually know the person who somehow persuaded her government in the Czech Republic to do something about handwriting. She unfortunately cannot be here today, but her website is up. Now, it's predictable she wouldn't be here because right now it's 3:45 a.m. where she is. Her schedule is very busy.
Actually, we've had people that come on, like from Iran, that get up in the middle of the night.
Yeah, she's a mother of two.
Okay.
A 11-year-old and a 4-year-old. The 11-year-old.
I got you.
She also has, you know, work, you know, she basically is a teacher and researcher and a graphic artist. She's, you know, very often interviewed in the media, both in her own country and elsewhere, actually. In fact, I interviewed her a couple of years ago for Writing Matters, which is the journal of the Society for Italic Handwriting. And, you know, some of the graphics that we will see are things from that article or from the Facebook page of the organization, which posted everything that didn't fit in the article. And we'll be talking, if you will, a little bit about the history of handwriting in the Czech Republic, what it has been like, much of which has been similar to things that have happened in much of the rest of Europe. But in any case, this is a little news article about her. Now, this, of course, is not the graphic artist in question. Maybe she's one of tomorrow's graphic artists, but this article is simply about learning to write in the Czech Republic, how it has been a certain way with some variations for many, many years, and it's going to be changed. What you see on screen, if you enlarge those letters, is what is being introduced, which is basically replacing a system where for many decades, writing had been 100% joined cursive of a very elaborate type from the get-go. And this had occasionally been changed, actually, literally, if someone in the government sat down and said, okay, let's change the way the cursive style looks. There was, for instance, there were a lot of complicated versions that coalesced into one version sometime around the 19th century. In 1932, there were attempts at simplification, which had not been very great, you know, in my opinion and in the opinion of the lady I'm about to tell you about. And this is what they have now, but it took a long time to get there. This is not yet in every school. The schools are fortunately being given a choice. They can have something like this to start from the get-go, or they can have the previous system, which was a really conventional 100% joined cursive with very elaborate letters from the get-go. And we will see.
This reminds me of the italic.
She is an italic writer. She does not call her system italic because, you know, why bring another country into the mix? In fact, Radana Lentsova, which is her name, and I'll spell it for you when we get to that. She actually named her system Comenia script after the Renaissance era Czech educator Jan Comenius or Komensky, who is, you know, very much the pride of their country in terms of educational advances, although he's basically unheard of outside Europe. But, you know, in the Czech Republic, he's basically has been a national hero. Now, what has made handwriting difficult in the Czech Republic has not only been that there's a cursive stage, very different from a printed stage, but that That's it. You go into first grade, the first day of first grade, you are writing a cursive system. Results, as you will see from some graphics we have a little later, have generally been horrendous. And what Radhana, my friend, who unfortunately could not be here, has noticed, as many people around the world have noticed, is that even if people are taught this from the get-go, and even if they're taught a conventional 100% joined cursive as the one and only thing, very, very few people use it. Radhana says nobody. I would say almost nobody, because I like to be very accurate, but a lot of people not only don't use it, but don't notice that they aren't using it, so they go on teaching what they themselves are not using. Now, people, when they see such a phenomenon in the USA, they tend to say, oh, that's because in the USA we have a print style and then we change to a cursive style. But we're talking about a country where basically since the 18th or 19th century, it's been a 100% cursive style from the get-go. And the results of that had been found to be very bad for a lot of people, particularly for anyone with dyslexia or dysgraphia. There is, you know, a theory around that cursive and joining every letter is supposed to be just great for dyslexia and dysgraphia. Let's just say they've met very, very few people who believe that, and the preponderance of them are not people with those conditions, but are people who teach and sell books about those conditions. That's something we should possibly do an episode about. Hope you don't mind. Cop car went by again, very apropos, because later on we will be looking at the fact that some of the people who are researching the new system are, believe it or not, the Czech Police Department's crime lab. And you know why? They do not think that the little kids who have a new and simpler system will go out and be criminals. This is a Wikipedia article whose link will be in the description. This is in English, but it's in English because I got it translated. Mm-hmm. It's in Czech Wikipedia, not in English, but I went to a few translation apps, ran it through, and picked out what seemed to be
the best. I do that all the time because I think it's a great tool.
Yeah, and people have to know, by the way, if you look at things to get translated, there's more in the world than Google Translate. I very highly recommend Yandex Translate,
which, oh yeah,
and they will do documents. In other words, they won't just do things you paste in or type in or websites. They will do PDFs. Of course, in my experience, you have to sit down and correct the spots they miss, but that always happens. Another great one, although it does not do PDFs, is DeepL. DeepL.com, which even gives you lots of choices of synonyms, which will help for things like this. In other words, very often a translation app, if it's translating something to do with handwriting, will pick a wrong synonym for a term. It might even translate the word handwriting as calligraphy. And in one instance, I saw it translate the word handwriting as typography. Okay, they're computers. They're not perfect. We're here to help them out.
Okay, this is what I would think about this. What would the cursive people think about the Comenius script?
Interesting. There have, much as in the USA, there have been people, many of whom are sort of older people, many of whom are graphologists, who really don't like it. I wasn't able to find any graphology articles in English in time, but Radhana tells me that among the graphologists, some of them really like it. Some of them say it needs improvement, but a lot of them hate it. A lot of them say things like, you know, this will destroy their brains and their emotion, which is, again, what we often hear from many, not all the graphologists in the USA, when people look at initiatives to simplify models. For that matter, we often heard this, or rather, the previous generations often heard this from graphologists back in the 30s, 40s, 50s, when graphology was a really big deal in the USA, the way it still is in the Czech Republic and most of Europe. And they had a lot more status and a lot more respectability than maybe we have today. You know, we should do a show just about like graphology, because I know several people in different schools of graphology, some of whom, let's say, respect a lot more than others. But regardless, a lot of people have said, oh, you know, because if you see a loop in handwriting, according to such and such graphology book, it means that this is that you're creative, and therefore if people don't have loops, they won't have their creativity, or if they don't join every single letter, they don't think logically. Well, what I like to do, and I think Radhana has also done this to an extent, is point out, well, if you look at the Renaissance, what is now Czechoslovakia, or rather the Czech Republic and Slovakia and the rest of Europe, had a very
I think it's fun what they're saying, though, because think about this, Kate. Some people can't write, and they are very logical people, and they could be scientists. What if they
exactly.
were
born with I don't buy into this, because when yeah. I had my handwriting, my personality didn't change.
Yeah, that's what I'm
but
saying.
But even if we don't criticize them, even if we accept such people on their own terms, on their own ground, for the sake of discussion, I would like to say, well, look at, you know, people from the Renaissance did not yet have a 100% joined, as Radhana calls it, and I sometimes call it, a Baroque handwriting with all the loops and all the joints. And you're not going to go and tell me that the people of the Renaissance were not creative or intelligent.
I have a question, Kate. So how different is handwriting right now in the Czech Republic from the way it is in Slovakia?
From what I've seen, I've not seen much from Slovakia. It's very much the same. Now, in Slovakia, so far, they've just been piloting, you know, the Komenia script in just one small administrative region, one county. In the Czech Republic, it's been around for about 10 years, being phased in. So they've been doing studies on basically for the past 10 years. Now, this is the English language portion of Radhana's website, Komenia-. Yes, she's been actually, she's-
See, I think you guys are great.
She's been telling people in her webinars that she does for teachers training to get this, because she and I agree that no matter how we write, we want to be able and to have the children able, the next generation, able to read what went before. And so far, the resource for that is English. And our most complicated cursive styles are very, very similar. Now, that's Komenia script. These are actually little 3D letters that...
I like this. Yeah, wow. That's cool.
And she's got a lot of stuff. She's got like little word games with tiles you put together. She's even got what amounts to a match-up memory game like concentration. Like if you've ever played the concentration game, you know, like you turn over a picture and you have to look for another picture that matches or is the same. Well, what she did, and she did a set of concentration for Czech and a set for English. And what she did was she found for Czech and then later on for English a picture that would fit the capital letter shape and the lowercase letter shape. For instance, for B, I forget what she has in the Czech alphabet, but for the letter B, she has a picture alphabet, and the English version has a bear sitting down, you know, a bear with like a big chest and a big fat stomach, and under, you know, capital B for bear. And then for lowercase B, she has banana, and it's a banana with the peel partly peeled off and curling around, so that the banana is the stem of the bee, and then the part of the peel that was peeled off and curling is, you know, the rounded portion of the bee.
And she, I love how she has the diacritic sort of hanging in the air there.
Well, they have to be there. It's super important. In fact, one of the big problems with cursive, as we've known it before I came along, was that kids and grown-ups too often forgot the diacritics, which are really important, and there's a lot of them. You know, in English, where do you pick up a pen to, you know, add something to a letter? I-J-T-X, you know, that's it. I mean, there are lots of vowels and some consonants that have these. They have to
what
be
about good. Turkish that
have I've seen of the Czech alphabet, I've seen charts, they have more, and a lot of these are counted basically as separate letters. If you leave out, okay, for instance, her last name, Lensova, it has an accent mark over the A, just the same as you see there, but it's Lensova. We tend to think, and I made that mistake of saying Lensova because I know a little Spanish. In Spanish, that just means it's emphasized, but in Czech, You have an accent mark over a vowel and makes the vowel last longer. And this can change the meaning of a word. Oh. Everything in Czech gets accented on the first syllable, but the accent marks don't always end up there because they're not stressed. By and large, their length. Some of them will show that it's a different sound. You know, on a consonant, if you have a little, you know, sort of a downward pointing arrow, it's sh versus s, and that sort of thing. But in any case, the diacritics had been a huge problem with cursive because if you're supposed to connect all the letters, the same thing happens when you cross a T. You get to the end of the word and either you forget it or you go back and, you know, you put it in the wrong place as often as not. And with the Kamania script, people are not doing this. And they're taught basically not to join the letters and pick up after the letter, you know, do whatever mark goes on to the letter, if any. Later on, you're taught basically to pick up after every letter. That's the default. But as you write, if you discover letters that can join without changing their shape, as you saw in one of these charts, you know, you can do it, but you don't have to do it. And if you, and I'm sure we will get to some of the historical charts, and you'll see that what they had in 1932, for instance, was very, very much what we'd see today in USA.
I'm just going in the order of everything that you put on the PDF.
Actually, a smart board app and an app for iPad and Android. And that one, actually, you can see the B for banana right there.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So I think that one is the same in, you know, this one. I, you know, forget what this is. I actually had, you know, put on the English version of the app. And what's cool, as she points out somewhere on the site, is that if you have pictures which then resemble the letters you're using, you're basically doing what happened in the history of writing. When you have letters, so those of us who are interested in archaeology and early letters know that if you looked at ancient Phoenician or ancient Hebrew writing, you know, thousands of years ago, the name of the letter was the name of some object that started with the sound of that letter. So originally the letter had a similar shape. And so she's doing this, you know, but not with languages, you know, that are 3,000 years old. She did it for Czech. She's doing it for English. And I have not seen yet, but I would assume she's doing it for Slovakian because her website's in three sections. There's the English section, the Czech section, and the Slovakian section. If you go there, you'll see a little tiny national flag in the upper right-hand corner. It's like teeny, teeny, tiny. And what you'll see is the Czech flag. But if you click on it, you'll get the British flag and you'll get the Slovakian flag. So if you know what the British one is like, you'll get English. Anyway, she's got a very cool site. I think we should probably go on to some of the graphics.
I'm going in the order of what you sent. So
very,
I just,
well,
I,
which is good, yeah. You know. I mean,
yeah, that's how I'm going to do it. Whatever you need. So I'll tell you what, next time if you want me to do that, send it in that order, and then I'll definitely.
Really know what order to put it in. It was basically an info dump because I wasn't sure what order to put it in.
Oh, no, it's okay. I'm just saying whatever. Like, I just think.
Yeah,
like,
I mean, the point is there's so blankety blanking much. So this is the difference. See, on the left is the model that basically they've had for a couple of decades. They had another version of it in 1972, very, very similar. Basically, super, super narrow. They were imitating an earlier style from their country in the 18th century. And I have to say, this is so narrow, it would be hard to write. And on the right is basically what we have, showing part of the Czech alphabet. You'll notice that CH gets its own letter, which I think sounds like, I'm not sure. And they put that actually after H, but it's its own letter. You'll see there's R twice because if you look closely, that's not a different letter, but she's simply giving two different stroke orders. One of the things about Kamania script is that she builds in a lot of choices. There's more than one way to be right, especially once you get past the first grade. They give you a lot of choices, a lot more than just this on how to do certain letters. Like your lowercase y can be pointed or rounded, and some other things get to change. Basically, have a sort of ballpark of acceptability, to use an American metaphor. And I'm sure Radhana will be listening to this later. And I'm not quite sure what that thing says in Czech. I know very, very, very few words of Czech.
I translated it for us, though. Let's see. Here?
I'm sure that we probably have someone for, you know.
Good. Oh, this ad right here? It's an ad. Yeah. I don't know. Well,
yeah, just an ad. Don't worry. It's an ad, but it looks like it might. It's an ad for something else. I'm not going to worry. It's an ad for some book or other. I'm not going to worry. Something about the culture of Czechoslovakia, blah, blah, blah. I'm not going to worry about that. So anyway, somebody just, you know, somebody just loves this. Now, by the way, this font is not hers. By the way, we should sometime do an episode on handwriting fonts, because that's actually a free font that was made for, among other purposes, literacy classes, but I have actually used that to teach basic handwriting. And it happened to be the font I was using today. We have some, now all this stuff is going to go into the description. You know, we have a lot of research topics. She's actually done research and partnered with people who've done research that she hasn't done, because obviously, you don't want to be the only person who's doing research or be on all the research teams if it's your system that you created, you know. However, she did organize a conference about 5 years ago on, specifically on the manuscript and where it was being used and what the results were. Research that was very favorable and is continuing and apparently will continue. They now have 10 years worth of lots of schools using it. And this is actually a research study, actually, that happened to be, this one happened to be in English. There are some other ones that were in Czech, but I was able to find some decent translations and sometimes fix up some of the vocabulary nits myself where I was capable of spotting them. You know, fortunately, there are Czech English dictionaries online that you can use to combat the excesses of computer translators. I'm not saying that computer translators are bad. They probably do a better job with most
languages. I think they've come a long way. They're getting better.
They used to be horrendous. They're still bad enough that you really need a person to fix them if it's anything more than I would like to order a hamburger. I've heard a rumor that a lot of the publicly available translation systems, the ones that kids tend to know about, are intentionally kept sort of imperfect so that kids will be caught out if they use them.
Yeah, you can't use it to plagiarize a paper.
Yeah, no. Because there are plagiarism tools. In other words, you know, you cannot stop people from using Google Translate on their schoolwork, but you can make it so that it won't work.
Okay.
The box.
You know, the thing about that is, like, I always thought that was bad. I always thought that's so bad. But then you go on Craigslist and these other sites, and they can find, kids are so savvy nowadays, and I think they've always been, they'll find somebody, but I hope the teacher's smart enough to just know that they don't find that.
Normally the teachers are, and there are all kinds of very clever systems that do textual analysis on typewritten work. I have actually heard that this is a reason that some teachers are going back to handwritten work, even for long things like term papers, just because if they have to write it by hand, at least that means they read it at least once. Mm-hmm. In other words, it's a lot harder. I'm not saying you can't plagiarize. I mean, plagiarism is as old probably as writing itself. However, if you're a fifth grader, you're probably less inclined to plagiarize. If you think you'll have to write the whole thing out anyway, you might think, well, I may just as well do it. I mean, I'll be honest. Of course, there always are, no matter what the language, what the writing, and what the topic, there always are people who just sort of mechanically copy without reading it, but they are easy to catch. You know, when you have a fifth grader who's been asked to write, let's say about the current Russian-Ukrainian war or something. And let's say someone, you know, is asked to write about, you know, are wars ever justified? Use the current war as an example. And let's say a fifth grader turns in a paper saying, in my 25 plus years of experience as a military theoretician, well, you know, the fifth grader didn't write that. And you also know the fifth grader didn't read that.
Unless they're so precocious. I mean, they're
25 plus years. they'd have to be precocious to the point of developing a time machine.
I know.
And if they do, and if the fifth grader can bring in a working time machine, I would say give him an A or her an A. But that really happened.
Anyway. I want a time machine, though. I want to go back in time.
Yeah.
I can't.
Look, I have had thoughts sometimes that if I had a time machine, you know, if there was a way that you could buy one, rent one, if this existed, I would like to go back in time to the Baroque era, find the first, you know, textbook publishers and authors who were doing just too much of a job of embellishing the script and saying, can you please stop it right there? And can you please make the fancier versions optional? Because if you don't, in 400 or 500 years, we're going to have this. And I would bring out, you know, a sheet of the ordinary handwriting of today. And I would say, can you please make it less difficult so people don't just give up or fight the system or just mess it up?
I have a new idea for you as a search engine topic. Minimalism is so big, so you should talk about the minimalism of handwriting.
That's a great idea, Julia.
You should. I'm telling you.
Although I would say some handwritings are too minimal. You know, we got in a lot of
You can say that in the video. You just have to have clickbait. You get them into the video and then you tell them.
You're right.
Definitely. Yeah. Listen, minimalism and there's minimalism. And I would love for us to put this somewhere in the schedule. By the way, do we have any comments yet or don't we get them?
I can't look at anything because I'm stuck in.
I don't know how to look at them. I know there's a way.
There is a way. It's just when I'm stuck in here, I can't change the screen and we'll go somewhere else.
I will let you know, Kate, if we have any, I'll put them on the screen. Okay.
Thanks. Yeah.
And I'll Thank only you. Say, put anything on the screen and it's checked or something you don't know, go to Google Translate and do the text language.
This is interesting. Already in the 90s, some experts as well as laymen criticized the existing script as unsatisfactory for left-handed children.
Yeah, and that's actually a big bit part of what Radhana has done. Radhana has actually given lefties a choice. She actually does a version of the model for lefties that gives them the choice that, for instance, for horizontal strokes, like crossing a T, that they get to go right to left on the strokes if they want to. Now, I would not necessarily do that. You know, this is an area in which I don't know that it's something that would work as well as she says it works. But look, there's been research. She found that at least a very large percentage of lefties apparently do as well or better and find it easier to learn. Now, my own experience with teaching handwriting to a lot of lefties and a lot of people with very confused dominance, including in some cases, people who are naturally left-handed and basically been beaten for it when they were little. My experience has been that if you have certain paper positions, certain ways of positioning the paper going left to right in the stroke will be as easy for left-handers as for the rest of us. However, Radhana may not have those paper positions. She seems to be more into a straighter paper position.
Oh, I feel like kids should hold the paper however is easier for them, right?
In some ways work better than others. It doesn't mean there's one true right and only way. I believe there's a ballpark and that you can experiment. And I would like to do one episode, which will involve a lot of illustrations, a lot of drawings about different choices of paper positions, hand positions. I am not one of these one true right and only way people, and you know that.
And I know. Yeah. I'm
not even one of those two true right and only way people, one for lefties, one for righties. When I teach, I actually give people a choice of four paper and hand positions, and they can adapt in those. But what Radhana does coming out of a graphic arts tradition that she is extremely good at, what she does is she does, as I recall, have the paper basically, you know, roughly front and center, which obviously is going to make it less easy for lefties to cross, you know, left to right. Let's say, you know, crossing a T or something like that. She does give them the choice. It works fairly well, probably because she is not you know, requiring or introducing joins at any stage. She just, you know, lets them happen if they happen and they don't have to. My own experience, I will say, teaching lefties has been different from hers. But remember, I'm working in a different language with a lot few diacritics. I'm working in a language where actually writing written words and what is composed of written words tends to be longer. If you take a long text in English and you translate it into Czech and you look at them side by side, the Czech one is way shorter. It's typically only 2/3 the length. So I know that a lot of features of efficiency are very different, you know, and this is, from what I see, it's the same reason that this also happens in Russian. You know, the grammar is different. Czech has case endings for a lot of things that we would have to have separate words, prepositions for. You know, you might think the words are longer because they're unfamiliar, but a lot of the words are actually a bit shorter. So it's probable that things which work reasonably well in Czech, and I don't know Czech, so I don't know, but this is my guess, looking at the language, having looked by now at a lot of handwriting in the language. Now, yes, disadvantages. Now, she actually sells a handwriting font, and in several versions, she says the disadvantages of having the font are, you know, that it's not going to be exactly like spontaneous handwriting, you know. Even our most sophisticated computers cannot really do what our hand does. And she basically says, you know, watch your teacher as your teacher writes. That's the most important inspiration and experience. But she, like various other people, has found it useful to have things out there for worksheets. Because
I like it.
But you and me, if I'm sitting and I'm writing a worksheet, even if I'm writing it once and I'm going to make 30 copies of it, I don't want to write everything by hand because I will get tired. It's probably better to have a decent font, even if it's not great. And this is great, I think.
This is a beautiful font. I love it, actually.
It's great. In fact, you know, she does sell it. She sells it to schools and basically people who need it, you know. So I haven't seen how much it costs yet, you know, because I have a fair number of italic fonts on that I was able to get for free. For instance, if you're familiar with Getty Dubay, which is a very similar system in the USA, they have a very wide range of fonts. And I got that basically for free because I was a beta tester. Now, this is not Getty Dubay, but this is another free font. Actually, the font that I happened to type in because it was something on my system that, you know, looked like Comanuscript, but didn't look like Comanuscript. I didn't want to look like it was ripping off the font.
Oh, yeah. So
but what it is that actually it's a free font that you can put in the descriptor. Andica New Basic, and that's the bold italic style. There's also an italic style, which is very cool. And they have, you know, non-italic styles, which are, I'd say they're cool, but they're just not as cool. Anyway, it's from a company that actually happens to be a Bible translation school. And they've made fonts in a lot of scripts to train the missionaries because the missionaries have to go out and maybe learn the language, you know, from people in the jungle. Now, that's my handwriting.
I like that's it, Kate. That's fun. Now, on the show, can you say it, though? You have to say it.
Yeah, with the show.
Yes.
Yeah. And by the way, I actually wrote that on the screen with an Apple Pencil, which is how I do more and more of my writing.
That is so cool. I love it.
And by the way, we should talk about tablet and stylus writings. For those of us like me who have problems with the stylus slipping, you know, which is relevant to any discussion of Radna's program too, because she's a stylus, you can actually get little rubber points that go over the point of a stylus and give you a little more traction. Now, this is not Radna's font, but I picked one. I said, let's find one that looks similar. So let's go through some handwriting history. And like a lot of things in history, we saw it originally 1200 years ago in the Czech Republic. Yeah, well, we saw, or actually more than that, this was, you know, a 9th century, we had much of what we had in the rest of Europe. We had the Carolingian script, which is what you see at the top of the page, which actually came originally from a Holy Roman Empire standardization effort, spearheaded by none other than Charlemagne himself and his palace think tank.
That sounds like something
which was sort of amazing when you realize that he could barely sign his name. He could read. He struggled with writing, and despite many, many efforts to learn. I mean, he literally went to bed with writing materials under his pillow so he could go practice before he turned in, you know. And however, Charlemagne, who was able to commission someone to say, well, we have a zillion styles and they're not standardized. Every village practically has got its own style. We need something standard. If you'll go back for a moment, you know, he was actually able to have a style which eventually warped and morphed into other styles. At some point in the Renaissance, earlier styles were revised and came up with what we now know as the palette. And remember, the Czech Republic, or what's now the Czech Republic, it has had other names, is part of Western Europe, after all, technically, if you think of it. And they, you know, and they were having in the Renaissance and before that, much the same styles that they would have elsewhere in Europe, although you did also see probably some Cyrillic. So from the history of writing, you know, 500 years ago, they had, this sample does not happen to be from the Czech Republic. It's from Italy, it's in Italian, but this is basically what they had. Now, if you scroll down a little further, we will see what happens when handwriting goes for Baroque.
Oh, no.
By the 19th century, it had devolved or evolved or changed into this. This style was known as Czech school Latin, not referring to the language Latin, but to the fact it was that it was the Latin, in other words, Roman alphabet. It was sometimes also called the English style because it had been copied out of English books, which is very funny because one of the objections now that people who don't like Comenius script in the Czech Republic or in Slovakia are raising is that this is not our nation, this is not Czech, or this is not Slovakian, when originally it wasn't any more than anything else. Just as we have people here who say, what to change, joining all the letters would be un-American, and they really say this. They grow and they get very political. I don't know if it's that politicized in the Czech Republic. From what I see,
I don't think so. I think Americans need to let some of this stuff go. They get a little too caught up on things.
Very, very, well, I don't, we can get into politics and handwriting.
This is not even political. This is just saying sometimes Americans need to be more, less insular. And this is
what I do. Think it overlaps with politics because the people who say it, well, let's say, I don't want to make any observations about current politics, which we can all fill in the blanks. But let's say they're very much the same people who wanted Lindbergh to be president back in the 30s. That's all I'm going to say about
that. Okay.
Fair anyway, enough. But to get back to the Czech Republic, this was a style very much what we also saw in England and her colonies, including, you know, what is now the USA, the style where you had thicks and thins emulating earlier styles, but produced by pressures. You had to push down, push lighter, push down, push lighter. As opposed to earlier, I was with a pen, did all the work. Now, these are what I, Baroque writing. I have sometimes used that term. Rodina uses it a lot. Baroque and classicist, or as we would say, neoclassical. And these are terribly elaborate, but these are things that were very typical of handwriting books. You know, if you bought a book to teach some kid how to do handwriting, how to improve your own, even the very simple exercises would have something like this. Now, if we go down further, we'll see that some of the excesses were pruned away in 1932. Basically, you know, let's just say that a lot of European countries, the government will decide how you
pruned away in 1932.
Now, this is very similar. Yeah, much of this is very similar to what existed in the USA at the time and also now. Later on in the 1970s, much the same forms were kept, but were made narrower. A later revision tweaked some of them, but didn't make really huge changes. You know, but we have to wonder, you know, what were the results of these? You know, people look at this and they say, oh, gosh, it was so beautiful back in the good old days. And, you know, everyone likes a bit of nostalgia, but it wasn't always, and it isn't now. And if we scroll down a little, I think we're going to see it's not always great. And now these are and have been the usual results. You know, I mean, I will tell you, back in the 17th, 18th, 19th century, if you were not gifted at this sort of handwriting, if it was just not something that you were able to do, you could be a dropout, go be a farmer or a blacksmith. You didn't have to mess with education, but now you have to mess with education, or education will mess with you. In other words, the people who had trouble writing, you know, can no longer disappear into the vast mass of the population, have a sort of decent life. The vast mass of the population needs to be literate. And even though so much writing is computerized, there are reasons that we have discussed, and I think we can discuss again, that handwriting still plays a role and is not going to totally disappear. I mean, there's actually research that if you learn to write with a pen as opposed to a keyboard, you will do better academically and in terms of literacy. People have misquoted some of that research. Or sometimes you see if people are not just scribbling, they try to fight the system. And many people will consciously or subconsciously try to minimalize things and try to strip it down. And we may not like how it looks, but those are the ones who are legible. As I understand it, typically in Czech schools, as in USA schools of an earlier generation and still some places now, you would be told, this is wrong, this is bad, this is wrong, this is bad. Now, funny thing is, I don't know how it is in the Czech Republic, but I know that in the USA, literally some of the people who tell you don't ever disconnect your letters and don't ever make it this simple have been people who subconsciously were doing this themselves. And we should actually have something on hypocrisy in the handwriting business, because there's been a lot of this. And even though this is not such great handwriting, I applaud the people who write like this, because they're trying to fight the system and they're trying to get something legible out of the system. So one graphic designer, Radana Lentsova, who is always is very young at heart and always looks it, thought there must be a way. I mean, I will tell you, if I didn't know who she was, I would have thought she was about 11. But believe me, she's a grown woman. She has an 11-year-old daughter and a 4-year-old son. And yes, wow. The 11-year-old daughter is in a school that does Kamania script. The 4-year-old is not yet in school. Now, her own handwriting, which she was gracious enough to let the Society for Italic Handwriting put on Facebook, had taken years to overcome its bad early environment. If you zoom in, we've got 3 pictures here and 8 more to come. I've tried to arrange them in what seemed to be the chronological order when we get to the bottom 8. And you'll see from this, you know, which is actually, I would not say her previous handwriting was good, but compared to some of the other stuff we saw, and these were upper grade kids in school.
I mean, she tried harder, it seemed, than some. I mean,
she did better than some, but look at, I have to tell you, I mean, I think that she obviously worked on her own handwriting very gradually, and from what I gather, talking to her, some of the changes may have been subconscious, others appear to have been conscious. Certainly now, she is very conscious of writing styles, and I think
she takes very meticulous notes. It looks like.
This is great. She takes loads of notes, but at least now
I do that too.
I can read these even teeny tiny on that little computer screen, and even not knowing the language, at least I know what the letters
are. Yeah, like S-A-V-I-I.
Right, you can see it. Okay, even if I don't know what the letters are, I don't know what the words are. Now, this was the result. This is what she came up with. Lots of books in the series, workbooks, exercise books, including one book for adults who want to improve. And you see, we even have very simple models. And later on, some calligraphic choices. We have little alphabet charts. This is made to go on a desk, and you can see the whole Czech alphabet. Now, what I thought was cool, if you stop here, when she has the lesson on R, what she did was made it about cars, because cars go, so I think, and on the right, you see that these are choices you get, which you get sometime around second grade once you learn the basics. Once you learn the basics, instead of being told, well, now you've got the basics, let's change the alphabet, you get told, now you've got the basics, you've got a few choices. If you like it to be a little more pointy, you've got a pointy version of K and Y. If you like your F to be a little more fancy, you've got that. But no one is coming around and saying this By the way, I mean, we have some names here. I know what photograph is. I don't know what the next two words are. I know that the bottom two lines say 3 days and 4 hours. Okay? Just so you know. All right?
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That's cool.
I'm not necessarily sure what all the stuff about car says, except for where it says tractor. Now, these are the results. And how old would you guess this kid is in? If you don't look at, scroll back. If you don't look at the caption, how old would you guess that kid is? If you want to show all the writing, but not the caption.
I don't know, like maybe third grade.
First grade.
What the heck? That's pretty good.
But if you want to know what the little flowers there are for, those are printed in most of the books. The kids don't draw them. They're actually used as a guide to what part of the letters go in what zone.
Oh.
So like it's a flower, and the blossom is for the capitals and the ascender. And the main part of the stem is for, you know, most of the letters that are short letters. And the roots are for the parts that go below the writing line. So that's a first
grade. It almost sounds like Spanish. Like, gustum. What's gustum,
mommy? If Radna was here, she could tell us. All you have to do is if you go get a Czech keyboard, get Czech software keyboard, you know, free from Apple, type it, pop it into Google Translate and hit detect language or hit Czech. It'll tell you what that is. Other than that, the first word I know there means island, because that's, Ostrov Ceylon, the island of Ceylon. If you scroll down to a little poem that whoever it is copied, and it has something about Buddha, and that's all I could tell you. Now, so when letters touch, they get to join, they get to, as Radna puts it,
I think Okna Kajdy Svatni is at the window. Every light.
That's what I think. You know, she wasn't here. I was hoping she could read this, but you know, whatever language, I know Kokosen is with coconuts. You know, that much I know. Raising coconuts, right. What's that? Rice, coconuts, and joy? I think so. I'm not sure, you know? As I say, my Czech, other than a very few words that I've learned in the course of looking at all this Czech handwriting, are basically what I can figure out from Russian, where about half of the vocabulary is similar. Some of the endings are different. So I look at this and I can actually read part of it, but I'm not claiming, I don't know Czech, I don't know what it means. Although I've written letters to Czech in Radana, I've done this with translation apps and then gone back and tried to learn a little from, okay, I wrote something like we're on in 4 hours, let's see, you know, if I can learn from that, you know, but I wouldn't say, I don't know Czech. If I went there, I would certainly want to learn. I've heard it spoken. It sounds like this beautiful, beautiful language, and I will say that. But anyway, I forget if this one was a first grader or a second grader, but now we have fourth grade, okay?
Wow.
I'd say some of this looks good, you know? Some of it looks like, okay, the person's a fourth grader, but if you see fourth grade and cursive, whether the person had cursive from the get-go, as in the Czech Republic, or had cursive from like second or third grade, normally what they write in cursive looks worse. Now, we should do a show on research. There actually was handwriting research a couple of decades ago that was done by some very reputable people, but that was promptly ignored right here in the USA, that pointed out that kids' legibility and even their spelling and the amount of vocabulary that they have in writing basically takes a deep, deep plunge when they are switched to cursive. And the earlier they're switched, the worse it is. And this was research nobody wants to hear then, and no one wants to hear it now. In fact, of the 5 times I've heard anyone quote it, 3 times were people who simply agreed with the research and were people who agreed with me. And 2 times were people who misquoted it and told me, I'm going to misquote it because I can't stand the research the way it is. And we got to do a show on that. Now, this is eighth grade. We've got some flow, you know. It's left slanted, which Radana does not tell you not to do. I believe that with the paper position that she has, a fairly straight paper position, and with the adaptation she makes for left-handers, you're going to get a percentage having a left slant. You know, and there are things I wish he would do differently, but they are comparatively minor things compared with the things I admire her for doing. In fact, the biggest difference between a lot of what she does and a lot of what I do is that I do some different things in terms of not having certain joints or having certain joints, in terms of turning the paper, in terms of hand positioning. You know, not all italics are alike, and I don't think I've got the one true right and only way. I like there to be a menu, and I would love there to be a handwriting teaching program that had like a little selection box where you could click off what you wanted to have in your handwriting and what you didn't want to have. In fact, I suspect, and I'm not allowed to say too much about research that's in progress, but I suspect from knowing some of the research that is in progress that one day we'll know a lot more. And I would say than we do now. And I would say, we'll get to this in a minute, I would say that one day we will. This is my own opinion, not from research, but only from my own observations, that one day we will be able to check children out when they go to school, give them a little screening, and if someone tests positive for more slant or for joining more letters or for whatever, we can give him that or give her that. And if someone is going to be have other tendencies, I believe that we will be able to find what recommendations we can give. And I think it would actually be wonderful if they had handwriting classes, and if they had classes that were broken down by what people would be able to do by their need for that subject, just as when you have gym classes, not everyone who goes to the gym is taking the same gym class. Now, this is a student with special needs. I don't know what grade the student is in, as the grade was not stated, and because it was in a PowerPoint that Rod and I used at a presentation, I added some little graphics around it, you know, but because Radhana at one point was, you know, I didn't, you know, it might have been her students, they didn't really feel comfortable asking. Now, this is before the school, the student with special needs, and most of the special needs students who've been covered in the research have dyslexia and or dysgraphia, and some of them have specific spelling issues, which let's just say is a bigger deal in Czech than in English, because Czech is a bit easier to spell, you know? So they actually, but this is before this school that this student was in adopted Kamenia script. He's struggling along with cursive. You can see he's trying his darndest. On some letters he does very well, on some he doesn't. It's obvious that joins are really a deal breaker for this young person, and look at, and like more than half of the stuff he wrote got the red pen. Now let's scroll down and see how he's writing out, or she. Now it's not great. We'll go down soon to see that cool picture, but it's way better. It's, in other words, have you noticed that this special ed kid, who I would think is fairly young given the size of the writing, is literally writing better than upper grade people who had a conventional cursive in the Czech Republic. Now, where this graphic came into the wrong place. I meant to post it in later when we have the Czech police report. I don't know this. You know how sometimes the PDF will put a graphic or into the wrong place? Well, this bit of my handwriting was a graphic. We're going to get to the cool picture later and some more. See, this works better than the upper grade students' writing we saw before. Okay, I see some of now we do have lots of downloadable resources. Now that little dark blue font is mine. It's a font.
Do you want to go back here? Or?
Yeah, that dark blue font, bluish green font, is one that I used that was free. I think you can get it from Google Fonts. It's called Kotpo, Kotpo. I just wanted something that looked like the handwriting, but also looked like one. Now, here is where the caption is. Okay, cool picture of Athena coming right up. Why do I have a cool picture of Athena in here? Because she is the patron and the logo of the Czech police force. And the Czech police crime lab, as I say, has been applying their wisdom to doing, to looking at notes. So what does kids' handwriting have to do with Czech cops? Well, they want to see, they're doing longitudinal research I'm the first generation to grow up with the new handwriting. And that generation has been in school for 10 years because they have to see what happens to the handwriting as you grow up. As you individualize, they want to know what happens to it because this is important. And finding, you know, writers of anonymous letters. Now, there's a machine translation I made of an article on the research that was in check. I threw the translation and picked up the bobble. But you'll be able to get the translation at that link. And this is looks like the PDF turned it back to the check.
Yeah, it did it.
Okay, but you can get to that link from the description and you'll see an English version and it will be somewhat obvious where the nits were. Ah, there we go.
Yep, we did it, yeah. You did it, Kate.
Turns out just font experts. But really, I have learned that the word for font in that language is the same as for handwriting. And these are handwriting experts. They're examining how the script develops. That conference was 5 years ago, 5 years of Khmania script in schools. Radhana Lentsova, I'm trying to pronounce it right. Okay. Things like MGR, by the way, is actually the Czech abbreviation for their term for a master's degree. So it does not mean manager. You know, she's got some managers. She's got some PhDs. This is part of security research. Uh-huh. And they've been looking at, in other words, there were people, and a lot of the people were in the graphology world, not the police world, who said, oh, you know, you're not going to see individualization because nothing's joined, nothing has to be joined, and so much like printing. Well, individualization does happen because we write, we're not computers, we're individuals, and what we write is going to be individual no matter what script it is. By the way, a little translation error that was confirmed for me from some dictionary research as a translation error is when it says the existing italic font. Italic is simply a mistranslation of a word that is slanted cursive. So italic font was meant to be slanted cursive handwriting. Handwriting terminology is a mess, and internationally things get translated that here. If you'll scroll up a bit, things that get translated, look at the contrast, right? Go down. Things that get translated into English in other countries tend to use English that's not native speaker English, no matter how hard they research. For instance, a lot of the English language research coming out of the Czech Republic and Slovakia talks about bound and unbound writing. I didn't know what this was. It turned out it meant connected and unconnected. But apparently there's so much been written in English that this has become sort of a standard term. And when, you know, papers written there are read here, you know, on the internet or in a conference.
Speaking of bound writing, maybe the curse of people in a hold us hostage to the writing. They don't want to let us go. So it's bad.
Well, you know what's sort of amazing when cursive people, and I've heard people say, let's just say some of them have some pretty intense things they'd like to do. Okay. Now, what's funny, when I talk with cursive people, they will very often say, oh, but why don't we Americans write in cursive? You know, every single country in the world, except the USA and maybe Canada, uses this beautiful cursive we used to use. And they just sort of flip and turn colors when I say, well, the Czech Republic's been phasing it out since 2010. And France has, you know, been giving a choice between conventional and italic cursive since 2013. And I point to other countries and I've literally been told, I cannot let myself know this. At one point, I literally was told, how dare this be true? An odd thing to say. Now, this is actually from the police presentation, looking at differences in spacing, shape, joining. Like you can see, these boxes contain the S, and we've got five different people, and they were all trained the same way, but they've got five different ways of coming out with a letter.
Yeah.
And, you know, and one of them is sort of close to the model. The others are not. So you are going to get.
Well, we need to grade them on the handwriting. I'm just kidding.
Yeah. And, you know, what's always amazing to me is that people who say, but this cannot possibly have any individuality. They're the very same people for whom nothing makes them happier than if their students write all exactly alike.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I don't know how to wrap my head around that. But if we scroll down, okay. So if we scroll down, well, we have a lot of stuff going on. Now, I am suspecting, and I do not know for sure, but I'm suspecting, and I hope that someone who watches this will correct me if I'm wrong, that the sort of graphologist, for instance, who says you cannot possibly dare to have this, this is wrong, bad, it will do bad things to their souls, and I actually have heard this kind of thing from, well, let's just say certain members of a certain profession. And, you know, some of the people in that profession are much more honest than others, and that's all I will say about that. But from some of them, I have heard, oh, we can't have this. I'm wondering if part of the reason they say such things might be because if the handwriting that people learn changes, what every graphologist knows, just like anyone else who really thinks about it, is that if you're looking at handwriting and you're trying to figure out individuality or whatever may be in the handwriting, you're looking at how do they deviate from what they were taught. And if what they were taught isn't what they were taught when you were going to graphology school, well, then at some point you're going to have to write all new books. There's someone who has to write, and this would be, you know, huge work. I wonder, and I have to say, I hope I'm wrong here. And I hope some decent graphologist can prove that I'm wrong. But I wonder if part of it is that, you know, the graphologists, who are a profession that is steadily increasing in age, because it's hard to get young people to sign up. I'm wondering if they are wondering, how do we face the consequences? You know, how do we teach people to analyze a handwriting which may be going extinct? Anyway, we have some more research, and this is again about the individualization. I think that you have seen a lot of individualization going on. When you originally thought that a first grader's handwriting was probably a third grader, I'm sure this was based not only on the skill with which the first grader was writing, but on the fact that you could see individual strokes. You could see things that weren't just copying the model, that were just a little individual flair.
I mean, yeah, because when you're a kid, it's a lot different because you have to sit in class and they're like, students, like, copy it. It has to look perfect. And
different. To some extent, you have to make sure it looks like what it's supposed to look like. That does not.
But then now we have grown-ups that can't write anything, and I'm like, is that okay? And then they get offended. They're like, yes.
Yeah.
And I'm like, is that a W? No, it's a V. And I'm like, oh.
Well, and I have to say, I have always thought, you know, I've always wondered, you know, why, you know, people have a very love-hate relationship with individuality. And part of this is sensible. I mean, it's good that we all write differently and individually because
if
we were to like one, it would be horribly boring. And number two, a large portion of the legal and document identification.
But here's the thing, Kate, like you always say, oh, you feel like you had to improve your handwriting. But part of me thinks that your young handwriting was probably so much better than a lot of these adults who.
It actually was worse. It actually was way.
I don't know. Worse. I feel like it looks. Do you have samples?
But you, I don't have one for. I used to have this whole box of them, but my basement was flooded shortly after I moved up to this area, the house I used to live in, and I lost a lot of irreplaceable stuff. Let us just say that I have seen handwriting which looks about as bad as mine. I don't think I could do it, my previous handwriting in all its original badness, but I could try. I could give you a very good idea. It wouldn't be quite as bad, but you would agree it was bad enough. Certainly the printed version, and even more so the cursive version, when that was inflicted and when I was basically grinding out cursive letters, you know, it might have said, the teacher might have said, okay, open the workbook and page 63 has honesty as the best policy and we're all going to be writing that. Well, I know what it meant only because someone told me. It didn't mean I could read it even if I was laboring away at the appropriate scribbles. Okay, now if you want to know what my handwriting was, the closest thing that you've seen tonight in my handwriting was Did you see the before sample of that kid who was in special ed?
Oh.
Basically, if you think of the distance between that and what it was supposed to look like, and if you go about that far in the opposite direction, as far away from what it was supposed to look like, that would have been my handwriting. In other words, whatever he's got, I've got it twice as bad.
Well, I guess if you say so, but I feel like your handwriting is probably better than...
Well, Julia, you have to understand.
Please, you just... Okay,
well, hear me out. I think your writing wasn't so bad.
I shouldn't have butted in. Look, I say what you're saying, and I think that I will only back you up. But I didn't
mean to interrupt. Okay, yeah. The thing is, many of us have hand-eye coordination issues, and especially people on the autism spectrum do have that. They can be very intelligent and yet have that problem.
That's true, but just as I was saying.
Let me tell you a little about myself, and I don't always tell this to everyone, although I do tell it to my students at some point. I have enough neurological stuff going on that you could probably write a guide to neurological diagnosis just and put a picture of me in there, and that would be the guide. But before I tell you what I've got, you're talking to someone who wasn't able to tie her shoes until she was 10. You're talking to someone who never succeeded in riding a bike with or without training.
Okay, I get what you're saying.
You're talking to someone, okay, let's just say that I had issues which were so severe that that people that I was sent to help me thought I was making it up. So I am a little sensitive. Let's just say, besides the autism spectrum stuff, let's just say I have enough disabilities to fill a hat. And I mean Abraham Lincoln's tall hat, not my little cap that I'm wearing. I've got the dyslexia. I've got the dyspraxia. I have got dyspraxia. I have got, let's just say a lot of other things, none of which was diagnosed when I was a child. I was considered by many people, including temporarily by at least one of my parents, to be mentally deficient. I won't tell you which parent that was, except that that particular parent was actually on the point of sending me off to be put away when I was quite small. And although the other parent did not agree, that other parent was sort of coming around to that idea. Let's just say that I wasn't, but let's just say that my issues were such, and some of them still are such, they simply are not maybe visible the way I live my life, you know. But
I totally understand what you're saying. So yeah, I get your point.
Let's just say that you did not see how I wrote until I was 24. You did not see the kind of writing that turned even teachers who had been very nice, vicious because they were nice but uninformed. There were people who, until they met me, had thought that every child could learn. And I, just by existing, unfortunately, changed their minds on that. You know, not that I wanted to. I couldn't talk about this without sounding as if I was writing some kind of sob story.
I totally get what you're saying. I guess I just have to go out on a limb and say, I had some really amazing elementary school teachers, like probably some of the best. Like when I tell people my experiences, they would never demean anybody, no matter what. So I guess I just have to say, I did not.
In at least two of the schools that I attended, and to some extent in another school, basically demeaning people was a way of life.
Wow.
It's not ridiculous. You know, I don't want to leave you feeling miserable, so I'll tell you something that will make you freak out.
No, I don't feel miserable. I just feel sorry for them, and I think they shouldn't be teachers.
But I want to tell you the freakiest thing. Well, okay, at one point in my life, okay, I happen to be a very good speller. Not when I'm typing, but if you ask me how to spell a word, I can. Mm-hmm. But given that, you know, now if I write it by hand, my spelling is good. If I type, it's still a calamity. Okay. But regardless, when we had spelling bees in school and people had to get up and spell this word, that word, even though I would be on whatever team I was, you know, they would split the class into teams. And even though I would win the victory for the team, usually not only the students, but even students on my team, and even the teacher would say, she must have cheated in some way. She can't possibly be intelligent enough to really know how to spell these words. And sometimes they would say this directly to me. And of course, I would wonder, sometimes aloud, but more often silently, if I'm dumb enough that I shouldn't be able to know how to spell words aloud, how was I smart enough to figure out some kind of means of cheating in a spelling bee conducted out loud?
I mean, that's absurd. That's just absurd. Some things are absurd, you know.
It is absurd, but unfortunately, if you are me, it's worse than absurd if the kids who are saying she must have cheated, but we don't know how, are the kids on your team that you got the victory for. If some of those kids are, you know, sort of the popular girls club, it didn't really have a name, but we all know what that is. And if they went to the teacher, and there were literally kids, mostly girls, mostly very well-beloved girls, shall we say, who went to the teacher and said, you know, we are going to go on strike as students, and we're going to disrupt the class unless you take her, you know, pointing to me, they didn't even normally say my name, you know, unless you can take her and take the points that she got in that spelling bee or in whatever it was that wasn't something where my handwriting impeded me, take those points and redistribute them among the rest of us, the kids on the team who came in second, third, fourth, fifth, you know, because we can't stand.
That sounds like communism.
And if the teacher does it, and if the teacher then says in class, you know, at one point the teacher was talking about, you know, something in biology, evolution, and went beyond what I think any evolutionary theory would say, that, you know, and some humans today still have the brains of monkeys, and we have an example right in the second seat of the first row, or whatever it was. And there were times when handwriting practice that I was given to be performed at the board in front of the class, and writing at the board is not a bad idea, but it can be if what you're asked to write is not, I will not disrupt the class, or is not something for practice, but if something like, you know, I am unworthy of education, I am unworthy of existence. And even if I could write that beautifully, should I be compelled to write it? Okay, and people do this. I mean, there were kids, the very few kids who refused to basically join in the fun. And it was fun for them. It was the assignment they loved the best.
It was a bad teacher.
You know, and ready, but you know my many, many, many flaws. The kids who refused to join in typically stopped refusing because either they knew on their own, or was soon made clear to them by their peers or by the teacher that if they didn't join in, they would probably be next in line for the same treatment.
Hmm.
Okay. And let's just say this happened in more than one school. It was not as virulent by the time I was in high school, which was a different school from either of the two most abusive schools, but it was there. And I'm not trying to whine, but I will say that in my experience and my observation, when a kid's handwriting is really, really atrocious, and somehow, even the more they try, the more atrocious it is. Unless the kid is very, very rich and his family has very rich, powerful friends who can pull strings. And I did see instances like that, too, with some people. Unless that happens, the kid can really be treated as a sort of subhuman, even if everything else about the kid is great. And frankly, not everything else about me was great by any standard. And I think that a lot of this is unfortunately coming back into play. It was sort of fading out for a while, but from what I can see in here, and I don't know about the Czech Republic, but from what I can see in here, we've discussed the issue of people misquoting research to make it seem like basically cursive is miraculous and nothing else to do, and cursive makes you smarter and kinder and nicer and more patriotic and even more graceful and all these ridiculous things. I have, unfortunately, heard on occasion from teachers who are quite frank about doing something that I think is appalling. And they've said, well, I read this thing about how cursive is necessary for us to have cognitive abilities. And this made it so much easier for me when I grade, you know, the math papers or the science papers, because I can just look at the ones where the handwriting is not cursive or the handwriting is bad in any way. And I know those are the less intelligent ones. So if they look like they did well in algebra or history or science, I know they're really not capable of it. I can put their papers to one side. And I know, and I have actually seen teachers who literally said that when there is, you know, a math exam and the kids are putting down the answers, showing their work, that even if the answer is correct and the work is correct, if it comes from someone whose writing is just too sloppy to be read comfortably, and I'm very sympathetic with it because a lot of writing is very difficult to read. If that happens, there are people who will basically decide that that student is, you know, well, I've been called everything from an ape to at one point a big dumb cow, and rather other unflattering animal metaphors have been used about other people. In other words, one of the problems with badly quoted research, and I have to say that looking at the Czech material, I did not see the research there being misquoted the way I've seen it quoted in the USA. I will say, and I want to say that, but one reason I'm very glad that honest research is apparently being done there and apparently being honestly quoted there, at least from what I've seen, is that when research is misquoted, in other words, if you're a teacher trying hard to just get through your day grading papers, you know, with the best will in the world, and your friend who's a teacher sends you something that a friend of hers was sent by a friend of a friend, and that basically has been misquoted to the point that it says, science says that unless you write in cursive and do it properly, you will not have a good IQ or, you know, whatever. If you believe that, that's going to affect how you address the students. And I was more than once in basically every school I attended at some point, I was either accused of outright cheating, as in you couldn't be possibly smart enough to have learned this, or if not cheated, basically being told it didn't count because there's something off with you. You didn't come by this knowledge honesty. You know, it didn't matter that I learned whatever the lesson was the same as anyone else, you know. And I'm not saying I'm great. I mean, there's stuff in math I'm never going to get, and I'll be honest about that. But I'm saying that to have people laugh at me and to literally treat me worse when I got something right than when I got something wrong, and literally to say, well, you know, it doesn't fit that you could have, you know, that you could be this bad at handwriting and be this good at all these other things that handwriting is supposed to be a sign of. More teachers believe in graphology and such than care to admit it. I don't know what to do. I mean, was I supposed to intentionally do it wrong because then I would fit a picture that they had? You know, if you have a problem all around, you know, people know, oh, you know, this person just had.
Yeah, no, I know the opposite kind of thing, that there was a certain child in our family who was known to be a mathematical genius. He had very bad handwriting, mm-hmm. and one of his, you know, he was taking high school classes in math, but his teacher in middle school that was responsible for handwriting said he should be held back because he was being disrespectful, yeah. because he was not writing. If he was such a genius, how is it possible that he can't write properly?
I was told this so much by the people. There were a lot of people, I'd say half of the people around figured I was dumb as rocks. Half of them figured that I was smart, and especially the ones who actually figured I was smart or at least normal, basically disrespectful was like the adjective most often applied to me by the people who weren't applying the adjective dumb, stupid. Yeah. And I was sent at the school I was in for first and second grade, I literally was sent to the principal twice a week or once a week, you know, in good weeks. And it was very often about handwriting. I was
you were sent to the principal over handwriting.
Literally, I
was. Oh my gosh.
Said that I was willfully being disobedient. Eventually.
So oh my gosh. You know, your teachers have no clue what real.
I'm sorry, but it was actually worse when they said that I was being smart but disrespectful, because when they figured I was trying hard to improve, they would then just say, oh, well, she's just stupid, you know, which was like more excusable. But you were saying, Jill, I did not mean to intrude.
No, you're fine. I'm just saying they've never had real classroom management problems. If you got sent to the office for that, they have no clue. Like if they had taught in LA, like, oh, a kid bringing like a gun or a bong to class, like what really happened, by the way?
You know, this was Brooklyn in the late 1960s, you know, nice neighborhood. But I will tell you that there were other, you know, I would say the classroom management would now be considered abusive. There was one classmate of mine who was like very, very glaringly dyslexic. Like literally she reversed everything. Gila, and I'm not going to mention her last name because for all I know she could be listening.
For sure.
And nobody knew what this was. And like, as I recall, she was sent to the principal for a while too, at separate times than me. They didn't want, you know, to send two kids at once, you know, kids might collaborate.
Because I might make the teacher look bad, you know.
But eventually they basically decided she was just really dumb, which was totally untrue, and they left her alone. But what I mean was she had symptoms of dyslexia to the point that she literally said a number 9 and a number 10 look the same because they both have a line and a circle. And literally they did, you know, and of course she was told that she had to be making it up. So like at first they thought she was a liar, and then they thought she was like psychotic and disrespectful. But then after a couple of months, they basically said, oh, like she's just stupid and her family gives enough to the private school so we can let her, you know, we can like let her go along, you know. But I did not have this. My folks were far from wealthy. They did not make, shall we say, extra voluntary donations that they were expected to spontaneously make to the school and to the people or the organization that was supporting the school. Let's just say, and even if they've had the money, nobody in our family would want to be told that you have to do something because it's voluntary, you know. To none of us does that make any sense.
Yeah, it sounds like a bribe, kind of.
Well, let's say the situation was complex. I don't want to talk about it because...
Okay, we don't have to go there. That's okay.
I don't want to do that because it wouldn't have had... I mean, it could have happened elsewhere. It could have happened at any school, after all.
It could have happened in a lot of schools. I just think these teachers are not good.
High school, which was a public school, you know? And even though it was a public school that was very selective of bright people who had to pass some very rigorous testing to get in, you know, subject area testing and a lot of things. And most people who applied, even if they'd been getting top marks in their junior high classes, didn't get in. But I will say that even there, I will tell you there, you know, it was very glaringly obvious that the kids who were picked on, not all the kids who were picked on, but that there were kids whose ability to achieve what they did achieve was considered somewhat suspect, as in either they're not really doing it, they're not really achieving, but they're somehow managing to fake or somehow managing to look smart when they're not. Or if they really are smart, if they're so smart, why can't they do what even quite ordinary people often manage to do, namely just write legibly in a way that does not, you know, sear the teacher's eyeball. And look, I've seen bad handwriting, and I know bad handwriting can be painful because mine was painful to my own sight, which nobody believed when I told them any more than they believed that I could not read cursive except maybe guessing the occasional letter or, oh, this is at the front of what they told me is my last name, therefore it's a capital G, you know. I did, you know, I could not convince them. I will tell you I will tell you that my father lived long enough to apologize to me, and my mother, who is still alive, did apologize to me. I'm not going to say who gave me the worst grief because they both apologized, but it's something that I have talked about in other contexts mostly privately. I will say that both my parents were English teachers, although the school they were teaching English in was not the school, any of the schools I was attending. And let's say that the school they were in was the kind of school that the kids show up with knives and guns and
real problems.
Oh, heck yeah. You know,
the real thing, not like, oh my gosh, like Kate Glassman didn't write perfectly today.
That I was literally, they knew me to be a very literate person who read all kinds of stuff and who knew a lot of things, and they couldn't figure, you know, why is her handwriting worse than someone, you know, who's like a semi-literate and comes to school drunk? You know, in other words, you know, someone who did not have, you know, and I will tell you to at least one of my parents, it was personally offensive in, you know, well, you know, offensive was literally the word that individual used. Also a word that was used by teachers to me often in public, that, you know, this is just an offense, not just an offense to the eye, which I agreed with, you know, but that it was just an offense that this could exist. But to get back, you know, from what I've learned from Radhana, they have made for many, many decades efforts to be very fair and very equitable in the Czech school system. This is what I've gathered from seeing, you know, the fact that, you know, from having read things that she's shown me about special educators whom she has quoted, and from having read the things she wrote, I do not see, when I see material from that part of the world, the derogation that I experienced and that I have to say still exists in many regards.
And yeah, there are many schools where there's teachers that have power trips, I think. And maybe it's on the upswing. I don't know. Like,
I think it's on the upswing here after it was on the downswing for a while because of people have, you know, associating handwriting with, you know, some sort of virtue or some kind of character excellence. From what I've seen, I won't say that's absent from what I've seen in material from the Czech Republic, but there seems to be a lot less of it. There seems, you know, I would say that, you know, among the graphologists, there might be more of it. I've seen a little bit and heard a little bit. I have never actually met a graphologist who is from the Czech Republic, but even among them, from what Radhana tells me, some of them don't like her system and some of them really like it. And here, when people look at manuscript or they look at similar things in the USA, you know, Getty Dubé, or they look at whatever, they often, you know, basically the graphologists here who are petrified and quivering in their boots about, but what will happen if we simplify in this way? There are a higher percentage of them here than I would imagine there. I mean, I will tell you, I enjoy having fun with graphologists. I have sometimes done things like show them samples like the first grader, not that particular one yet, but samples from kids in various countries who learned similar scripts to Kamenia, namely italic scripts, and ask them to guess, well, how old is this kid and how is he or she doing in school? And they will do very much what you did. They'll look at a first grade sample and say, third grader and probably doing pretty well. And I'll say, oh, that's a first grader. I'll say, oh, that's the one. Oh, you thought this one was, you know, doing well, wouldn't have had any problems. Well, that's the one who was in special ed. Let me show you this kid's before Henry. And I have some before and after samples. And I will tell you, I really enjoy sometimes getting a graphologist and showing them befores and afters from the same individual. You know, I don't have mine. Most of my students don't give permission, you know, but you know, I have one or two things on the website where I'll put them up, you know, without saying it's the same person, without a name on there, and just say, can you tell me about the different characters of these individuals? And they'll say, well, number one of these two kids you showed me, these two school kids, you know, number one is really a psychological piece of work. He's probably, you know, got all these problems, blah, 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 blah. And then the other one, oh, he or she is going to be, you know, I don't typically tell them, you know, if it's a boy or girl, but I say, so they'll say, he or she is terrible student. He or she is, oh, this one's a very good student, probably, you know, joy to all the teachers. And then, and probably would, you know, I say, so you don't think either of these people would be capable of being like the other, even if they tried? No, they're just very different characters. So I say, all right, number one and number two are the same person 3 months apart. And they'll flip. And they'll, sometimes they'll say I had to be faking it. And I will always say, well, these people are on my website and I have their contact info. You can call them if you like, you know, but somehow they never do. So I have to say, I am not necessarily a fan of every single country in the world other than my own. But I do think that if people are doing something with tax money, even if I like privatization of all kinds of things, you know, if they're doing things with tax money, at least I want to see the tax money spent sensibly, spent the way that I would hope to spend the money if it happened to be in my pocket.
And well, I mean, we can give them credit where credit is due. At least they're actually trying.
In other words, it would have been so easy. I mean, there are not that many other countries, and certainly not the USA, that research handwriting before someone makes a decision in some unit of government, be it city, school district, state, whatever, mm-hmm. in France. And I'm not a terrific fan of France. I like some things about France and don't like some things about France from what I know about it.
Well, they're getting kind of weird. Like, okay, look, you might not be like ultra conservative, but I have a problem like when they tell a girl under 16, oh, you can't wear a headscarf anymore, or they go to the
beach. I have a huge problem with that. I have
a big problem.
But
yeah.
I will tell you, you know, at least when it comes to handwriting, they actually research the issue. And they researched the issue actually after years and years of making very emotionalistic decisions that basically nothing needed to be changed or nothing could be changed. At one point in France, for instance, they were going through a period where the decision makers would say, yes, we've got to change what we've got. It's got horrible results. But then when someone would say, well, how about making this change, that since you said this part was a problem, they'd say, no, but we can't change any of it because then we wouldn't be French anymore. But then suddenly, I guess it got... Yeah, they had to. We can talk about the French situation sometime because I actually have somewhere in my files the, you know, French Ministry of Education's research report, you know, in French, but I know French. I mean, I've never been there. I studied French for 6 years, so I'm entitled to a teensy bit of opinion about them, even a lot of opinion, you know, but I certainly studied the research. I love to bring up France, by the way. Maybe we can do that for another episode.
That would be fun, but yes.
There are so many of the cursive promoters basically use France as an example, and they don't know. And I say, well, you know what? This thing that you say is a great example. Well, they wrote a report about how it was really terrible, and they finally went and changed it. Mm-hmm. And not that, but they changed it to two systems, both better than the one that you think is the one they should have stuck with, and they're giving schools a choice. I mean, it's interesting. I'm glad that schools are getting a choice in the Czech Republic, in France, in so many other countries, and I'm glad that in the Czech Republic, the choice that, well, at least one of the choices even has further choices built into it. I mean, it would have been pretty well inconceivable when and where I went to school that someone would, you know, give you a choice about two different ways to write, you know, the
letter. Oh, no. I mean, nobody got a choice when I was in school either.
And what was really annoying to me, and I have to say that I'm saying this only because I'm pretty sure that it must be otherwise in the Czech Republic, at least now, what was really annoying to me was that I'd be told to do it some way, you know, this is the way everyone does it. This is the way you have to do it. You know, you do all these cursive capitals. You have to join all the letters. And the teacher would not do it. And of course, I would be the one raising my hand and saying, you know, Miss Fucklepop, you know, Fuddlepop, you know, you'll have to take this out because I just accidentally cursed on the air. Can you bleep it out?
You didn't curse. You're okay.
You didn't curse. You're fine, Kate.
You're fine.
Miss Pucklepup or whatever, just make up a name because I don't want to quote anyone's real name because a couple of them are still alive and really old. You know, you said that everybody has to join all the letters in the word, and you wrote on the board, you know, whatever word, you know, constitution or, you know, whatever, and your C didn't have that little curly Q on the top that you said all the capital C's always have, and you picked up the pen to dot the I in constitution instead of waiting two more letters or whatever. Or I say, Mr. Corfinswarf, you know, just making up made up words here. You gave me back this paper and it said, sweetie, we are big boys and girls now in the fourth grade or the fifth grade. The fifth grade is when I had a guy teacher. And you have to realize that big boys and girls and grown-ups always join all their letters and have all their capitals cursive, not granted, which was the way that particular individual would talk, not usually, but when he really thought that he was dealing with an ignoramus, you know. And I would say, well, Mr. Corfinswarf, and don't worry, it's not his real name, this person is still alive, for all I know, he could be listening, you have right here on this piece of paper, you're doing all these things you said that you don't do and nobody does. And what I would be told was it would be anything from, you know, you're just being very disruptive to, you know, what do you mean? Come on, I'm the teacher. How can you criticize me writing like you do? And I write like how could you criticize me? We know when you write like, you know, a drunken chimpanzee, or you write like a cow that has, you know, picked up a crayon in her hoof, you know. And
I would love to see that, though, if a cow does that.
Well,
they have to be on the show.
Very well, if I saw a cow like that, I might feel nervous about eating steak ever again.
But I would just ask the cow what it, I'm just kidding.
Well, let's just say, or sometimes, and unfortunately this was very often, and this was even before I was diagnosed as having something neurological, anything neurological, people knew stuff was up with me. Someone would, you know, this teacher or others would say, well, you know, you have to realize, sweetheart, your brain is not working right, or maybe your eyes are not working right, you know, you have problems. I need you to sit here and look at what I wrote until you can see that it is really cursive and really joining all the letters and really having all the, you know, you need to look at this really hard until you can see it. And, you know, I never could. And eventually I told him, and basically he basically concluded that, you know, I couldn't even, you know, see or perceive anything. So basically from that time on, eventually, he basically alternated between hating me and just considering that I was really, you know, really the awkward squad, really the one who was never going to really fit in or have anything click. Okay, I'm not going to say anything. I didn't use his real name because, again, he lived long enough to be sorry. He knows what I do for a living now. He, you know, approves, but you would never... He would never have thought it of me. He couldn't figure out how someone as dumb as I was got into the school where I was for third to ninth grade, because that school actually required IQ tests and all kinds of things, and I passed them with a very considerable margin to spare, as everyone had at that school, which didn't stop the kids and the teachers from thinking I was stupid. Now, we all knew that there were some kids who were dumb as rocks, who got in and who had parents who had given a lot of money, you know, private schools are, you know. I'm not saying all private schools, but many of them, if they want you in, it's not always because you meet the criteria. It could be, let's just say it could be for other reasons.
I mean, we know.
How did I get in? My family, you know, how did I get in, let alone you know, and let, you know, how did I get in, let alone get a break on the tuition? Like, not a full scholarship, but apparently some kind of break. No one could figure it because my folks were not wealthy. And most of the people at that school were very, very comfortably well off. And my family was not. They couldn't, you know, they couldn't figure it out. And I think that just made them hate me more. But I will tell you, it is not even just a modern pattern of abuse. I do not know if others have experienced it, but there's actually documentation that as far back as 1900, when people, at least you would think they knew a little more about handwriting, even if they were into the really fancy filling stuff, it's actually documented in, among other, in at least one place, a study from Yale Psych Lab, that a handwriting teacher in 1900 was writing to a handwriting researcher and mentioned in passing that, you know, I would never, you know, lift the pen within letters or permit any of my students to do the same. You cannot be fast and you cannot have consistent writing if you let the pen leave the paper. And so the researcher who got this, who had been getting letters from, you know, teachers in connection with his psychological research on the movements used in handwriting, and it's very good research, especially from 1900, he discovered some very important stuff. He actually sat down with that sample, took one paragraph, the paragraph where the teacher, who was a very, you know, a very busy professional teacher of handwriting, as such as there used to be, you know, there used to be teachers running actual schools and institutes of handwriting back then, you know, like it would be a career you could go into. And he counted every word in that paragraph, there were 63, and he counted every place where the pen had visibly left the paper inside a word in a place where in conventional cursive, certainly in 1900, it wasn't allowed to. And he found 28 pen lifts in those 63. Oh. 28. And most, and words that had them often had like more than one. For instance, the word leading was in that sentence. And it has, leading has seven letters. You want to guess how many times Mr. I never, 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 never pick up the pen? Picked up the pen within the word leading? Guess.
Three, four.
Actually, he picked it up before the A and before the D and before the G. Three times in a seven-letter word.
I think, I think if I write something, I pick it up, I'm pretty sure.
And you probably pick it up. I can actually predict where you picked it up, and I've never seen your writing.
I don't know. Or maybe I'm not.
You might. You could go write something while we talk, but I would say that most people who pick up the pen actually pick it up. Exactly, this guy picked it up. And even the researcher, I'll tell you, even though the researcher didn't remark on what letters it was picked up in front of the most, he had a tabulation. He had a little table of every letter that was lifted before. And what, you know, he basically typed out what the guy said and he put like, and every letter that was picked up before, he put in a different font.
I do know that when I'm writing, like if I do write something in cursive, that I do pick it up sometimes. I can't keep my pen on the paper.
Exactly. Oh, God, I'm going to tell you some stories. And the only reason I'll be telling you those stories is because similar stories apparently have been coming out of the Czech Republic. People are realizing I don't keep the pen on the paper as much as I thought I did.
No, I always knew that. Yeah. Not,
but from articles I read about what people, Radna did not tell me those, but she, but some of the things she said implied it. But to get back to the situation in 1900, which was very much the situation in the Czech Republic up to 10 years ago, you know, the, from what I've seen of handwriting emanating from there, and what I've seen of handwriting emanating from the USA in 1900, or really in any other year, is that the places where people pick up the pen, four times out of five, are when they're going from the baseline of the writing up into a rounded letter. Mm-hmm. For my generation, you can remember, you and I were put through all these things like join into the letter C and all these sort of swoop-de-doo things, and we don't do it. Now, although the researcher who was studying handwriting motions in 1900, a guy called Cloyd McAllister, who was actually very eminent as a researcher in psychology and other areas too. He was actually at the Yale Psych Lab after all. Although he didn't draw that conclusion, he did, as I say, have a tabulation of what letters the pen was lifted before, and 4 out of 5 of them were before A, lowercase A, C, D, G, O. There wasn't any Q in that paragraph, but I'm betting if there was, it would have been lifted. And this is what I see when I look at people who subconsciously lift the pen before a letter, whether in the USA, the Czech Republic, or anywhere else where people have historically been told you join up all your letters or you go straight to hell, or the equivalent. You know. And for some people, it's been like that. For some people, it's been you join up all your letters or you're a bad person, or there's nothing other than either joining up all your letters or just printing some horrible printing. Or, well, when I see the pen lifts happen, the ones that people make without knowing it are predominantly before, from the baseline up into a rounded letter.
Okay, that makes sense, though. That's what I am
when I look at the writing now from the Czech Republic. When the kids invent their joins, they invent them in good places, and they typically don't invent joins up into a rounded letter because they're figuring out those don't work.
I have a thought about all this cursive stuff. Do you ever think that the people who insist that we write in cursive all the time have Stockholm Syndrome for writing? You know, maybe.
They have. In other words, given that Stockholm Syndrome, which not everyone knows, is that when you're abused and terrorized enough, you sort of fall into some helpless love with your because you get to be. I think some of them do. I won't say that all of them do. I won't even say that many of them do. But I know that there are people who just talk about how I just love cursive because I used to hate it. But Beeble Meyer was so strict with us. And then one day I woke up loving it. Or I really knew I would always love learning what the big boys and girls were learning. And then of course, you know, sometimes they say, didn't. And then I just loved it. I think a lot of them basically love it out of sort of terror. But a lot of them, I think, like it because some people can do it much better than others. Just as some people are very good at acrobatic diving or riding a unicycle or synchronized swimming or all sorts of things that, you know, are very nice to look at, but not all of us can actually do. You know, I am not what I'm accused of being. I'm not someone who would think that you have to line up all the cursive people and get them to stop. You know, if you can do it, you like it, go.
Not all of them.
But that doesn't mean that, you know, but the fact that there are Olympic athletes who can do kinds of incredible things on the ice skating rink or on the gymnastic equipment, and we can watch them and applaud and give them 10.0 out of 10, that doesn't mean that all of us are going to do it. Imagine if the only kind of exercise you were allowed to have was either some very simple baby kindergarten thing or advanced Olympic level gymnastics, not allowed in between. You know, the health situation in any country would be worse than it even is. And this is what we have for handwriting, that either you have something that, you know, can be conceptualized by a small child that maybe cannot be done by a small child because perfect circles are very hard to do. Or you have, you know, the glories of the 19th and early 20th century pen masters. In other words, if you tell people there's nothing in between, you know, how would this be for anything else that we want to do or need to do? Imagine if, okay, I don't know if you're wearing this apron because you were cooking dinner or whatever, but when I see your apron, I think of a chef. And when I think of a chef, I think, how would it be if you learned how to cook, whether it was from your mom or your dad or from cooking school or from one of those great YouTube videos? Suppose if I went to YouTube to learn how to cook better, suppose the only two categories of YouTube videos on cooking were either how to boil water and how to make ice cubes, or how to create a 19-course French gourmet banquet, you know, or something. And imagine if there was no recipe in between them. And imagine if I then went to a dietitian or a nutritionist and she said, Well, that's because you're not allowed to eat anything but those.
Oh, I think we'd be in trouble.
I say that scribally we are in trouble. In other words,
that's a good analogy.
People who complain that the current generation hates handwriting, or complain that the current generation cannot read cursive, let alone write cursive, let alone write legibly at all, they have to say, well, the people who are saying that are the people who taught the current generation.
The generation
did not wake up. You know, the people that we are deriding as the millennials born in the year 2000 and thereafter, or even the earlier people. I mean, there's documentation as far back as 1980 that most of the teens and young adults were giving up on, you know, what the uncursive that they were supposed to do. But the people who criticize the kids for not knowing something or for not wanting to do something are the people who reared those kids. It's not like the kids of America all got up and said, we will start our own school and attend our own school and learn only what we want. No, they had the education that they were given. And we see this a lot in many areas. People, for instance, I'm sure that on some of your other shows you've talked about social trends and things like, well, you know how there are sport leagues that claim it's politically incorrect to have a winner or a loser. And I don't like that. But what I think is ridiculous is that a lot of the people my age who don't like it, if you pull up their records of what they did when they were young enough to start sports leagues going in the town or do something at school that was extracurricular for the kids, you'll find that the same people who are now, you know, slamming their own children and grandchildren for, you know, how dare you be in that horrible, stupid team, you know, or that horrible, stupid, whatever it is, or how dare you be someone who doesn't know all the things I knew when I was your age, like, you know, how to iron a pair of pants or something. Well, they're the people who started this. In fact, I have to tell you that some of the people actually, you know, who say they're all angry and upset that their kids can't do any number of things, whether it's things that I do not think are important, like writing cursive, or things that I think are important, like reading cursive, or, you know, learning poetry or learning art or learning all kinds of things. If you look at if you look at the decisions that were made by the school board, when the kids now cannot do whatever, we're going to school, or the kids might do them poorly in the case of things like very poor handwriting, the people who signed off on these decisions were very often the same people who a few decades later are, you know, slamming the children and grandchildren who were educated to the decisions.
Yeah, under their decision.
Someday, you know, in 1970 or 1980 or 1990. And I'm going to say, you know, there are people, and you have to say, and what's very scary is that certainly sometimes it's something like a school abolishes something. Like, I literally have run into people who worked at schools that at some point said, well, handwriting is going to be pointless and a frill, and we don't need it. We have telephones, we have typewriters. Let us not teach it. And then a few decades on, these same people are, you know, blaming their own kids and grandkids. Some of them, though, it's sort of the flip side of the story. Some of them, you have schools and you have districts where people are very much teaching, you know, well, this worked for my grandma and this worked for my grandpa and it worked for me. It's going to work for the kids. And they teach it and it's not working. Now, I'm not denying that there was that handwriting, cursive, or whatever was a lot better for many people decades ago, centuries ago. But remember, this was a time where if you, you know, couldn't make it all the way through school, you could go off and do something else with your life, which I don't think was a great situation, you know, but it existed. This was also a time when you had people growing up and seeing a lot of letters around them being written by hand, not just, you know, letters that are done as a font in a book, printed someplace, but if you grow up watching people write letters by hand, you will get a lot of incidental learning that you don't get. In other words, there was a sort of hidden curriculum that, for better or worse, does not exist. No teacher now can assume that a six-year-old who walks into the door of the first grade has ever seen people ever write even one alphabet letter by
hand. I think a lot of parents aren't writing as much anymore. In fact, I think somebody told me recently, because of the pandemic, they were concerned that their kids were like not even writing at all, because even when they go to school, all the work is on the computer.
Exactly.
And, yeah.
But I would like, I mean, a lot of people write to me and buy my book or ask me for help because of the pandemic. And because they were stuck at home with kids and noticed what the kids were and were not able to do. I would say, if you have such a person in mind, certainly tell them about my book.
I will.
I will also do after the show, I will send you, and you can distribute as you wish, anywhere you wish, my list of my favorite internet free or cheap resources for improving your handwriting. And all of the ones that I've seen working that are on the list, you know, are basically, I would say, practically identical cousins to Khamenia script. That one is not on the
list. Khamenia is beautiful. Yeah. I like it.
Beautiful. Now that one, okay, honey, I love you. Can you put this down, honey? I'll get it. My darling knows I get up and I get, you know, I start needing to eat. So he walked in with, you know, a granola bar, and he's so good to me. You know, he always does this before he turns in. You know, he doesn't always do it, but he does it often enough. You know, I don't want to go and sit with something myself because I will just get hungry and eat it if I do, you know. Mm-hmm. But I will tell you, sometimes, not always, but sometimes I just need something. But I will tell you, the reason I am not yet referring to Khamenia script is I know that Radhana is in the process of proofreading the English on her site, and she's, you know, she's checked out some of the usages with, shall we say, various people, and I don't want to refer most people to there until the English is really good, because I want its message to be clear, you know. And mostly what's, you know, I mean, her English is very, very, very good, but it's, you know, but sometimes terminology is, you know, signs you don't know what terminology is actually used, and you sort of have to guess. It might not be in the dictionary. And of course, anyone writing in another language can always have improving times. I've had to write something in a language that was not my mother tongue. It was not English. I have always had someone else look at it, unless it was, unless it was something like leave the mail by the front door or something like that, you know?
Very simple.
You know, very, very, very simple. So I will tell you, I think her site is awesome. I certainly have told her about the part where she's plugging my book, because, you know, that's one of the pages that she's really worked on. As she's worked on more pages, I've told more people, because I think that it deserves to be shown at its best. So anyway, I will tell you that I get asked often, so often, by people who need handwriting help. And I know that Radhana does too. I don't know. I know that she's written a book specifically for adult bad writers. Some of the graphics on their website actually show graphics of parents who improved their handwriting along with their kids, and even wrote little handwritten books as like supplements for schoolwork, which is like awesome. But I will tell you that I get asked so often for resources that people could use on their own, you know, that I actually made up a list of a bunch of my favorite sites that I'd say, read these first, and read the first one on the list before all the others. And I made it into a text expansion shortcut so that basically I can type a couple of letters into a message and it spits it right out. I don't have to sit and type URL. Now, I will send it to you. And in fact, the big thing, the first thing on the list, is something that I wish we had a way to present, but we can't present it on this show without falling afoul of copyright laws, because it's a one-page sheet written by a couple of Radhanas and my colleagues here in the USA, who actually know of her have been to at least one of the same conferences, although it was a virtual conference that I was at. But actually, last month, there was actually a virtual conference on written expression. And Rodna was there, and I was there, and a couple of my other, a few of my other colleagues, including the two, wrote this one-page thing, which actually appeared less than, I think it was less than a decade ago, in, of all places, the New York Times.
Oh.
The one-page op-ed by these two teachers. And if you follow it, you won't need me, because if you follow it, you are going to end up with such great handwriting that someone's going to think you either, or that you work for me, or you work for Rodna, or you work for the people who wrote it, but you won't. And it would, and if you know how big a page of the New York Times is, like, you know how it's like gigantic. Well, they filled up this full page, so you could literally take it out and put it as the poster on your office. And that's in your office, and that's the very first thing I have there. And I'm saying this because a lot of people have said to me, well, knowing that there are books in another country where your friend works is all very well, but what's here and what's now? And, you know, if the New York Times, of all people, can be persuaded to tell us to improve our handwriting, I think there's hope for all of us. But I do have to say, in the Czech Republic, Rodna must be a real fireball, because it's such a small country and there's like five times as much coverage of handwriting and how to improve it there as I've seen in the whole USA plus Canada over the same period.
Well, I like what they're doing, and I think that's a great story that you covered. So thank you so much for sharing it, Kate. It's wonderful to hear about.
And by the way, we should see, have any chats come up? I'm actually going to open the chat.
We didn't have any chat. I would have told you if there were.
Well, yeah, although I thought you might have forgotten. We were so busy. Well, I'd say let's call it an evening.
Sounds good.
Yeah, okay. Especially because it has gone weird. My video camera went all gray when I tried to get into chat. But anyway, let's see what happens. I hope Rodna will be pleased. And, you know, because she won't be listening to this now. But, you know, right now it's, the Czech Republic is 6 hours ahead of mine, of where I am, which means it's 7 hours ahead of where Ayai is, and 11 hours ahead of where Julie is. So look, it's 11:43, so a quarter to 12. You know, she's probably just getting up right now.
It's early for her. I totally get it.
She's got it. And, you know, I mean, she's got the weekend, but she's got loads of things to catch up on, you know, and I'm sure her kids have got homework. Anyway, I've got to get off. I'm wondering.
Okay. Good night, Kate. Anyone... Thank you so much for telling us
thank
all
you.
This.
Good night, and thank you, guys. Thank you, Kate.
So let.